In today's video, we're going to continue to talk about this concept or phrase of intimacy with God. This is part two if you haven't watched the previous video called Intimacy with God. What is it? Is it biblical? Please make sure you watch that video just as well. But in that video, I just tried to explain what intimacy with God means, because we don't see that phrase in the scriptures. It's not a phrase that pops out as we're studying the Word of God, but we hear it all the time. We're challenged to be intimate with God, and we're wondering sometimes, what does that look like and what does that mean? At the end of the day, you look at certain terms in the scriptures, and the one term that consistently, as I researched and studied the scriptures, that popped out to understand intimacy is a term called access. You and I, as sons and daughters, as believers, have all been given access. Access is granted to those via relationship. Kids are allowed access into the home because of who their parents are, their access into the refrigerator without having to have to make a request, or, you know, because my house is my children's house. So because of relationship, they have access, and we all have access to the Father, and it's simply because of our relationship with Jesus. What Jesus has done for us has now granted me 100% access to the Father. It's not based upon my good works. It's not based upon whether or not I'm a perfect Christian or a growing Christian or doing well or not doing well. My relationship is secure and based off of what Jesus has done for me. He was the perfect Lamb. His sacrifice was satisfactory to the Father. It fulfilled the requirements of the law, and thus now I can have, you can have, relationship with God. But many people do not experience intimacy with God, even though they have access. Access is a gift that was given to us, but in order to experience intimacy, we must fellowship with God, and this is our responsibility. I think that's a key difference of understanding fellowship and relationship. Relationship is because of what Jesus did. Fellowship is our responsibility. If you see this word right here, it's called response. It's our response to having access to the Father. But what is fellowship? What does it require? What are the results that we can look at or expect as having fellowship with the Father? I want to begin with what it entails, because when you kind of understand the nuances of fellowshipping with God, you can kind of have a good gauge of whether or not you're doing so. The first one is it requires our attention. You see, in order to fellowship with God, you have to let go of your attention toward other things. You give your attention to God for a time or a period of time. You give your attention to the Word of God. You give your attention to the promises of God. You give your attention to singing to God and putting your mind on God. So fellowship is going to look as though you're giving attention to God. Secondly, there's going to be an aspect of adoration. You know, one of the previous habits that I've created is just to walk with God. It's a short walk, 15, 20 minutes, but I talk with Him and I fellowship with Him. And I found, without scheduling it or planning it, throughout these walks, I just break out in a time of adoring God and letting Him know you are great, you're amazing, you're worthy, you're holy. And that's just a result of fellowship, is adoration. Communion is an aspect of fellowship with God, that I commune with the Holy Spirit, that I'm talking, I'm listening, I'm dialoguing, I'm thinking, I'm going back and forth. This is not just about me getting away from the busyness of life and trying to calm my mind. No, this is about communion with the Father or with the Holy Spirit. An aspect of it that I think is very important of fellowship is solitude. Solitude doesn't mean that there's no people around. It just means that you broke away from the people that are around. You broke away from the phone and the computer and the TV, and you set yourself a way to what? Give yourself attention to God, to commune with God. And so I believe solitude is very important. It can happen in different places. It's easy sometimes to put your headphones in, and that will allow you to have a place of solitude, but it's more or less breaking away. We see in the life of Jesus, he often broke away into the wilderness to pray, and he encouraged his disciples to do the same. And we see throughout the scriptures that God called the men of God away from their chaotic, busy life to fellowship with him. So solitude is an aspect of fellowship. Another aspect is it's unhurried. You don't rush this idea of fellowshipping with God. You don't try to just get to the end or check off a box. This is about you slowing things down. And unhurried, it is more about a posture than it is about time. It's not about, you can fellowship with God in a short amount of time. Like I said, a 15 minute 20 walk, I'm able to fellowship with God, but I'm not hurried. I'm not trying to get to the end. I'm not just trying to accomplish something. I'm not transacting with God. It's about me being unhurried, giving attention, communing with God. And the last aspect is it's about abiding. Just like you would abide under a warm shower, you abide in his presence. You allow yourself not to be rushed, to allow his presence to soak you, his goodness to cover you, his love to envelop you. It's about abiding. And I think abiding is very key when it comes to fellowshipping with God. So those are the aspects of fellowship, but what is the result? What can I expect? What can I look for knowing that I'm fellowshipping with God rightly? And I don't mean that there's a formula to that. I just mean that if you're truly fellowshipping with God, giving him your attention, adoration, communion, you've broken away, you're unhurried, and you're abiding in his presence or abiding in his word, these are the results you should begin to see. I started to notice that I started to capture God's heart specifically toward people. I started to see people from his perspective. I started to have compassion for certain people that maybe I was bothered by. I started to love others that I was maybe frustrated or annoyed by, all because I started to capture God's heart. You start to capture God's heart for the lost, for those who disagree with you, you start to see his heart. So one of the results of fellowshipping with God is you start to capture the heart of God. The next one that I noticed is I started to learn his ways, why he does what he does, rather than just what he does. I want to know his ways. Why did you lead me that way? Why do you talk to me that way? And I started to discover how he does, how he leads me, how he speaks to me, why maybe he allowed this and didn't allow that. And it's very comforting when you start to know his ways, because although he's not predictable, his ways towards you are constant. And that's one thing I enjoy is I know God's ways, that he's going to allow certain things in my life, not because he's punishing me, but because he's developing me and he's preparing me. So I begin to learn his ways. Another result that I begin to see is I started to know his will. I started to have within my own heart, my own spirit start saying, man, I know that's God's will. I know that he wants me to go right, or he wants me to go left, or that he wants me to plow forward. Or you know what? I know that he's given me the green light, even though he hasn't given me direction. And you start to know his will, and you can start to walk with conviction knowing his will. The last one, and this is probably the key of all, and it's the reward of all, is you start to discover him. Remember, fellowship is not to get more anointing. It's not to get more wisdom. It's not to transact. I'm not transacting with God. If I fellowship with you, then you'll... No, this is about the end reward is him. It's about knowing him. Jeremiah 9:23 and 24 says, the rich, they will boast in their riches. The strong, the mighty, they're going to boast in their strength. The wise are going to boast in their wisdom. But let him who boasts in this, that he understands and that he knows me. In Job, it says, or Daniel, it says that we will do great exploits, those who know God. John 17:3 says, this is eternal life, that you may know him, the one true God in Jesus Christ, who he sent. So knowing him and discovering him is what it's all about. That is the reward. That is the goal. It's not about a bigger ministry or having more anointing. It's about discovering him. So I started to capture his heart. I started to learn his ways. I started to know his will. And then lastly, I started to discover who this Father is inside of my life. Okay, so it's a lot about fellowship and what happens, but what does it require? And this is something I don't want you just to overlook or skim through, but it requires time. Fellowship requires time. Just like if you were to go to the gym and work out, if you want to get physically fit, it requires time, an investment of time, a designated time that you will utilize for this purpose of fellowshipping with God. It requires listening. You know, there's a time to share God what you're going through and to talk to him and to praise him and to read scripture, but there's also a time to close your mouth and open your ears and listen to what the Spirit of God is saying. Listen to what God is trying to communicate to you in this season of life. It requires that you see with the eyes of faith and not just your natural eyes. Oftentimes when I come into a time of fellowship, I will ask God, Lord, I'm seeing life this way, or I'm seeing this person this way, or I'm seeing this circumstance this way. How do you see it? Help me to see what you're seeing. It's like Elisha and his servant. When the servant saw something from his natural eyes, he began to panic and freak out because he saw an army that was surrounding them. But the prophet said, Father, open his eyes that he may see what I see. And so fellowship is a time where you begin to see things from God's perspective and you posture as one who wants to see things from his perspective. You know, when I'm fellowshipping with God, one of the requirements is to learn how to be a receiver, to receive. Father, I receive your wisdom. James 1:5 says, he who is neglectful or lacks wisdom, let him ask of God and God will get it freely. God is a giver. He has given us all things that pertain to life and godliness. And receiving is an aspect of that. How do you receive? You do it by believing. So it's like, Father, I receive your favor today inside of this situation. Father, I receive your wisdom that I know only you can give. Father, I receive your joy that comes from your presence and gives me the strength that I need. And so you learn how to receive during fellowship. And lastly, it's protection. Protection of two things. Protection of the time that you designate to fellowship with God. And number two, it's protection of what God shares with you. I often like to journal. It's my way of protecting what God shares with me. So I write it down so I can review it and go over it and pray through it. And that's my way of protecting. Anything valuable, you protect. You put valuable things in safes because you want to protect them. And so intimacy with God, it all begins with access. Access is a gift that is given to us through relationship, but you only experience intimacy when you truly fellowship with God. And you do it through the ways that I've shared. And this is not a formula. You're not transacting with God. You're there to know God, to discover who he is, to listen to his heart and his voice, and watch the results. Watch what happens as you fellowship with God. You will be greatly delighted. I'm sure you'll be blown away. And I just encourage you to commit the time to do so and watch God move inside your life. Thank you for listening. Thank you for sharing this with others and also for subscribing to this channel. God bless.